السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
عليكم السلام.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، نحمده ونسبحه ونقدسه على آلائه ونعمائه، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، إلها واحدا أحدا فردا صمدا حيا قيوما، نؤمن له بالربوبية ونقر له بالعبودية. من يهدي الله فهو المهتدي، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. ونشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك وترحم على محمد وآل محمد، كما صليت وسلمت وباركت وترحمت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين، إنك حميد مجيد. وصل اللهم وسلم على أوصيائه وخلفائه. عباد الله، أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير، الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا وهو العزيز الغفور. صدق الله العلي العظيم، وصلوا على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
Chapter number 67 of the Quran, entitled Al-Mulk, which refers to the sovereignty and the ownership of the dominion of this world by God, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is named so similarly to other chapters which are named after the introductory theme of the chapter. And in this particular chapter, the first few verses speak about the sovereignty and the dominion of God, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the first verse sends blessings upon the one whose sovereignty is above everything in creation. تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكِ. Praise be to the one who in his hand, and of course the word hand in relation to God, when it appears in the Quran, is metaphorical because God has no physical hand. But his hand refers to his authority. تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكِ. Praise be to the one who in his authority is his sovereignty. وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. And he has ability upon everything, meaning that he is omnipotent. The strength and the authority of God can be exercised in every corner of the realm of the universe. This is one meaning which is implied. The word which is chosen here is particular, the word mulk, which comes from the root word which is comprised of three letters, mim, lam, kaf, malaka. And these letters, this word, appears in the Quran in many different styles. So God is referred to in Surah Al-Fatiha, which is the first chapter of the Quran. Al-Fatiha meaning the opener, which opens the Quran, the introduction to the Quran. He is referred to as Malik Yawm al-Din. And in some recitations, some reciters of the Quran, if you've paid attention, they recite it as Malik Yawm al-Din. So Malik Yawm al-Din or Malik Yawm al-Din, both words are very, very similar in their meaning. And they come from the same root, which is comprised of the three letters Mim, Lam, Kaf. Malik Yawm al-Din or Malik Yawm al-Din. So this chapter says تبارك الذي بيده الملك. Mulk is also similar to what is owned by he who is a malik or a malik. So malik or malik is the owner. Mulk is what is owned, that which is owned. And again, this word is used in different fashions and different styles in the Quran. So one style that it is used is the word malakut. And exegetes of the Quran have suggested that the word malakut refers to the dominion of God which is unseen to the human eye. So there are things which are seen, and that is referred to as mulk. And there are things which are unseen to the human eye, and those are referred to as malakut. And in the case of the word malakut, that which exists or is in effect but is unseen with the naked eye, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that there are a few that have been given access to the unseen realm. They can witness what is unable to be witnessed with the naked eye. And one of those people is the Prophet Ibrahim. And in these days we remember Ibrahim because we are in the month of Dhul Hijjah. And during the Hajj season, we walk in the footsteps of the Prophet Ibrahim. And God says about Ibrahim, he says, وَكَذَلِكَ نُرِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ مَلَكُوتَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَلِيَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُوقِنِينَ. And thus, we have given Ibrahim, we have shown Ibrahim, مَلَكُوتَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. So malakut is that which is in the dominion of God, in the realm of God, but it is unseen. And that which exists in the sky and that which exists in the earth, because there are things in the sky which are unseen, which we cannot see. And the sky isn't just, you know, this atmosphere which surrounds the earth. The sky also includes that which is beyond that as well. And the sky, so in the dua we say, we speak of the seven skies. So the seven levels of the atmosphere, and also beyond that as well. He says that we have given Ibrahim access to that which is unseen in the sky and on the earth. Things which are in effect, which we cannot see with our naked eye as human beings. And what is interesting in this regard is what God mentions as a part of the story of Ibrahim, which is mentioned in chapter number 2, Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 240. And this is an episode which takes place in the life of Ibrahim, where Ibrahim essentially asks God to show him that which is unseen. And one of those things which are unseen is the ability of God to give life to that which is dead. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ, he says, and so Ibrahim said, رَبِّ أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى, my Lord, show me how you bring the dead back to life, or you give life to that which is dead. So God says to him, أَوَلَمْ تُؤْمِنُ, do you not have iman? Do you not have belief? Iman is belief. Do you not have belief? Ibrahim says, بَلَى, yes, وَلَكِنْ لِيَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي, but I want my heart to be at peace. Now, this arises several questions. Ibrahim was a prophet, and it was the job of Ibrahim to teach people about God. I mean, he got into several serious exchanges with people about the existence of God. Number one, his own people, and that's why he had to leave them, because his own people, the society that he was born into, were idol worshippers. And after he left them, he went on his journey, and within his journey, in the middle of his journey, he met a tyrant, a Nimrud. And Nimrud had claimed himself to have godly powers, to have divine powers. And so he debated him with that, until his story ends where he comes to the Valley of Mecca, and after reconstructing the house of God, he returns to Palestine. But Ibrahim, in one occasion, he asks God, he says, I want to be at peace. And this is a reference to another verse in the Quran, because God says that the prerequisite to entering paradise on the day of judgment is that the heart is at peace. Your heart has to be at peace in order for you to attain paradise. And our heart being at peace, you know, there's an element of being at peace with our Lord, and there's also an element of being at peace with ourselves. And there's an element of being at peace with other people. So if we haven't forgiven ourselves, and if we haven't forgiven other people, then we are not truly at peace. And so forgiveness to ourselves and forgiveness to others is in large part a prerequisite to achieving that peace which will allow us to experience the paradise. يا أيتها النفس المطمئنة, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the soul, the nafs. ارجعي إلى ربك راضية مرضية. Come back to your Lord. And this is in reference to the time of death, where we go back, our souls go back to our Lord. Our bodies stay here, but our souls go back to our Lord. Come back to your Lord. راضية مرضية. Come back in a state of peace. That you are at peace with your Lord, and your Lord is satisfied with you. So this is what Ibrahim was asking for. He wasn't asking necessarily for an increase in belief, because Ibrahim, I mean, to be able to sit in a catapult and be launched into a fire from from a long distance away, we don't know how long the distance was. We know that people had been saving, the people of his town, when they decided to cast him into the fire because he had destroyed their idols. They say that single mothers would not eat and they would not feed their children so that they can purchase fuel, they could purchase wood so that they can throw into the fire to create a fire which was so great that they would make sure that it would devour Ibrahim. And that it was so great that they could not just toss him from a close distance, they had to catapult him. So they couldn't handle the heat and they catapulted him. So imagine the faith that Ibrahim has to have to sit in that catapult and wait to be launched into a fire, knowing that God is going to protect him from that fire. And God says, Ya naru kuni bardan wa salaman ala Ibrahim. He directs the fire to be a place which is cold, a place which is cool, rather than being a place of heat and torment, that it becomes a place of a place which is cool and an abode which is welcoming for him. So he has that great faith, but Ibrahim is also acknowledging the fact that there are degrees of spiritual knowledge, and not everybody is at the same level of spiritual knowledge. Not everybody's at that same level of yaqeen. There are those that are close to God, that are very close to God, and they are the people who have reached the highest levels of spiritual knowledge. By the way, it's impossible for us as human beings to reach the top of the scale. Why? Because God, His essence is infinite. God's reality is infinite. So there's never a stage where that we get to where we cannot learn anything more. We cannot experience anything more. But Ibrahim is asking for an increase. He says, I want my heart to be at peace. And I want you to reveal to me some of the things that people cannot see with their naked eye. And so he says, I want you to show me that thing which is reserved for you. There's one thing which is reserved for God, and that is bringing the dead back to life. And so God tells Ibrahim, he tells him to take four birds, and there are different commentaries on what type of birds God told Ibrahim to take. So one commentary says that he took a peacock, an eagle, a raven, and a rooster, four completely different types of birds, and to slaughter them and to mix their remains and to place their remains on top of four mountains, and that is to signify four different directions, north, south, east, and west. And then Ibrahim stood back and he called upon God, and God brought those birds which had been killed, which had been slaughtered, their remains had been mixed, he brought them back to life in their proper form. And commentators say that there's a number of reasons why Ibrahim may have asked God to show him that miracle. One reason, they suggest, is that Ibrahim, during his journey, was standing along the coastline, and he saw different animals preying on one another. So big birds preying on little birds, birds, little birds preying on fish, so on and so forth. And they're consuming one another. And so he wanted to know, well, how is all of this going to be resurrected? How can God breathe life back into that which has been preyed upon? That which has, been eaten apart and torn apart and preyed upon. That's one reason commentators mention. Another reason they say that this proof that Ibrahim was asking to witness would be used as a proof against his antagonist. Now, his antagonist is not mentioned by name in the Quran. But narrations tell us that his antagonist was An-Nimrud, the tyrant, the dictator, who saw himself as a god. He saw himself with divine attributes. And that, he had the gall and the audacity and the nerve to where he looked to Ibrahim. He took a bow and arrow. He placed the arrow in the bow and he shot it towards the sun, towards the sky. And he says that this is how I injure your Lord, the Lord that you claim to worship. And that when it rains, he's injured or something like that. And this man, who saw himself as a divine being, it's said that he died because of the bite of a flea or a tick. This man who is so great and so powerful, a little flea gave him a bite and he died because of that. And there's something very, very humbling about that. And in Surah Al-Mulk, which we're speaking about, the second verse speaks about how God has created death in order to humble human beings. To know that we're limited. To know that as great as you are in this life, whatever you own, you can build an entire empire, but one day you will be humbled by death. And death is a reality which everyone faces. Rich, poor, black, white, Muslim, non-Muslim, citizen, king, slave, free man, all of us face death. The angel of death also faces death. And there comes a time where God's sovereignty, his mulk, he says, لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ. To whom does sovereignty truly belong? And he replies to himself, لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَّارِ. Only to God. Qahhar means the one who makes things humble, because he makes us humble through death. So, two reasons. One is that he wanted to see how life would come back to that which has been devoured. Number two, that it can be used as proof against Nimrud, his antagonist. And number three, they say that it is possible that he wanted confirmation that he was a prophet. And that after he was ordered to slaughter his son, Ismail, he wanted confirmation that he was truly a prophet. He wanted one more sign that he was a prophet. And so God told him to slaughter the four birds, mix their remains and place them on the top of the mountain so that he can show him how they come back to life. So this proves that there are degrees in spiritual knowledge. And Ibrahim's doubt was not really, it wasn't hesitation. It wasn't on a reflection of his hesitation that there is a God or there is not a God. Rather, it was because he wanted to receive the highest levels of spiritual knowledge. Even our own Prophet, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In chapter 20, verse 114, he says, وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. He says, my Lord, increase me in my knowledge. And that's the prophet, the one who we consider to be the greatest of creation and the most knowledgeable of creation. So it's not the prophet's ignorance, but rather it is a reflection of God's limitlessness, that his reality is unlimited, that no matter what level you reach in spiritual knowledge or in faith, that God is still higher than that. And so God says, كَذَلِكَ نُرِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ مَلَكُوتَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. For that reason, he had requested that he gets a sneak peek. You know, sometimes you go to the movie theater and they'll show you a preview, a sneak peek of the movies that are about to come, you know, in the next 3 months or next 6 months or next year. Why? They want you coming back. They want you to know that there's something better than what you're watching right now. That there's something waiting for you if you come back in 6 months or a year. Great marketing technique, but it's a preview. It's a sneak peek. So God was showing Ibrahim a preview, a sneak peek of what it's like, what the unseen realm is like. And, you know, what we know from the Quran and the Hadith is that this world and the things in it, that which is seen, is a tiny speck compared to that which is unseen. I mean, even science today is telling us that what we know of the universe and what we can see of the universe, is so insignificant compared to what is unseen and compared to what is unknown. On the radio, they were saying one time that our universe, as large as it is, the billions and billions of stars, the galaxies which exist, all the planets, everything that we know, comprises only about 3% of the known universe. And 25% is made up of dark matter. And the rest, whatever is left, 70-something percent, is made up of dark energy. And these are things which we can't see with the naked eye. What we can see is the 3%. The rest, the 97%, we cannot see. And it's dark energy which allows the universe to expand. And the universe is not only expanding, it's accelerating. The more it expands, the faster it goes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, what in Surah Al-Dhariyat, وَالسَّمَاءَ بَنَيْنَاهَا بِأَيْدٍ وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ, that we have created this universe within our ability, meaning within our control, because some people suggest that God created, but then he did not continue the creation. It sort of just got out of hand. It became too much for God to control, and everything sort of created and developed on its own. But God says, no, we created it with our authority. وَالسَّمَاءَ بَنَيْنَاهَا بِأَيْدٍ وَإِنَّا, and we continue to accelerate it. وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ. We're accelerating the expansion of the universe. So what we cannot see is so much greater than what we can see, and that's why the Quran is always telling us about death. It's telling us about the afterlife. It's telling us about that portion that we simply cannot see, which is really this life, again, insignificant to the next life. There's a hadith, one of the prophets said to some of his followers, some of his disciples. He said, or they had asked him, what is this life compared to the next? And so they were given a picture. So he responded in the following way. They were given a picture of one of the earlier prophets in front of them. And as it's narrated to us, the earlier prophets, they lived much longer lives than we did today. So we're told that Ibrahim, or we're told that Nuh, for instance, the prophet Nuh, was with his people for 950 years. And he lived longer than that. And the other prophets, they also lived much longer lives in comparison to life expectancy rates today. And when that prophet was brought in front of them, he compared this life to the next life. He was sitting, he stood up, and then he sat back down. And he said that my standing, that's how long this life was. The hundreds of years, it was just like I was sitting, I took a break, I got tired of sitting, I stood up, and then I sat back down. So really, this life is insignificant. That's why the Quran keeps on telling us about the next life and keeps telling us that this life is insignificant. Because there's a world out there, there's a dominion which is under the control of God, which is so much larger than what we think. But many of us are oblivious to that. For a number of reasons. Maybe it's our attachment to this world. Maybe it's because we're truly ignorant of what lies. And if we become knowledgeable to the degree of certainty, then our behavior changes in this life. It's like, I always give the example, one of the scholars, he gives this example. He says that if you were to describe heaven to a human being, it's like trying to describe this world that we live in to a baby in his mother's womb. Because a baby receives his sustenance from the leftovers of what his mother consumes. But a baby doesn't know that there's an all-you-can-eat buffet waiting for him and all different types of food and all different types of drink. And the baby thinks that it has it, even though there's it naked, no clothes, but it receives its warmth, it receives its protection, and it receives its sustenance. So it's content with what it receives. It wouldn't know what is in the outside world until it experiences what is in the outside world. Human beings are very much the same. And that we don't understand what's waiting for us in the afterlife because we consider ourselves content with what we have in this life. So, the next verse speaks, and I'll end on this note. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكِ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. Praise be to the one who within his authority is his sovereignty. And he is omnipotent. He is all able, omnipotent. الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةِ. He created two things. He created death and he created life. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ. For the purpose of testing you. أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Testing you for what? What is he trying to reveal? You know, when you get tested at school, they're trying to reveal something, right? It's not how much information you know, it's how fast you can answer a test, right? That's usually how it is in today's schooling system. But what is God trying to reveal? لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Which of you are the best of amal? Amal is amal concerns all of your deeds. Everything that you do, everything that you create, everything that you say. That's why we created death. We've given you just a few years, 60 years, 70 years, 80 years, 90 years on this world. But we've created death so that we humble you and that you know that there is a test. That 60 or 70 or 80 years is a test. And tests really, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, what we understand from the Quran and also from the hadith is that God tests those whom he loves. According to one hadith, he says the following, the Prophet says the following. He was asked which type of human being suffers the greatest trials? This was a question which was posed to the Prophet Muhammad. He says the following. He says the prophets, those are the ones that are tested the most. Then those who are most like them, whoever is most similar to the prophets, meaning in their actions, in their speech, in their demeanor, whoever is closest to the prophets. And then he says the following, a person is tested according to the level of his faith. If his faith is firm, his trials increase in severity. And if there is weakness in his faith, he will be tried accordingly. So we're tried based on the firmness of our faith. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to be among those who pass his tests. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us in this holy month, the month of Dhul Hijjah. In a few days, on Sunday, is the day of Arafat. And there are a number of recommended prayers and supplications to be performed on that day. Here at the IECOC, there will be a women's session on Sunday starting at 12 p.m. Where the supplications will be performed. In congregation. And then on Monday is the day of Eid al-Adha. And we will be praying Eid al-Adha here at the IECOC. And the doors will open after 6:30 a.m. Dua al-Nudba, which is recommended to be recited before every Salatul Eid, will begin at 7:15 a.m. sharp, followed by Takbirat, followed by Eid prayer at 8 a.m. sharp. And we'll try to be out of here before 9 because we understand Monday is a work day. Please keep in mind that because it is a work day, that we have to mind the parking spaces. So in the same way that we park for Friday prayers, please do so for Eid. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر وصلوا على محمد وآل محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونسبحه ونقدسه على آلائه ونعمائه ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك وترحم على محمد وآل محمد كما صليت وسلمت وباركت وترحمت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد وصل اللهم وسلم على أوصيائه وخلفائه وعترته وأهل بيته علي أمير المؤمنين وقائد الغر المحجلين وعلى البضعة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين وعلى سبط نبي الرحمة وسيد شباب أهل الجنة الحسن والحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والخلف الهادي المهدي عجل الله تعالى فرجه وسهل مخرجه وجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه عباد الله أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل. Today is the commemoration of the martyrdom of the fifth Imam of the school of Ahl al-Bayt, Al-Imam Muhammad al-Baqir عليه السلام. And I'd like to share with you a couple of the traditions which are narrated on his authority. One of the traditions says the following, that no mixture of two things is better than the following. No mixture of two things is better than that of forbearance and knowledge. So knowledge in itself does not only suffice, and forbearance in itself does not suffice. If you want a great mixture, it's knowledge and forbearance. And the word for forbearance is hilm. Forbearance is outstanding. It's not just patience, it's outstanding patience. Sometimes you can be patient, but patience in itself also have degrees. According to the hadith, there are different types of patience. So there's patience when it comes to trials and tribulations. There's patience when it comes to the decree of God. Knowing that everything that God sends your way, good or bad, that you will be able to handle, that you will be able to endure. So different levels of patience. One of the highest levels of patience is referred to as hilm, forbearance. Imam Ali alayhi salam says in this regard, and Imam Ali had fought in many battles. He was the standard bearer of the Prophet Muhammad, and he fought in his own battles when he became the leader of the Muslims, the Imam of the Muslims. And he says, out of my experience, he says that I found that forbearance, that level of patience, is greater to me than the bravest of men and the most courageous of men. And Imam Ali had witnessed very courageous men. He fought alongside the most courageous of men. He had in his army the most courageous of men. He says, I found that forbearance, patience, is more beneficial to me than the most courageous of men. So Al-Imam Al-Baqir says, no mixture of two things is better than that of forbearance and knowledge. In another narration, he says, three of the best morals of this life and the hereafter are the following. So these are three of the best morals which will help you in this life and the hereafter. Number one, forgiving one who wrongs you. And how many times are we wronged on a daily basis? By strangers? And by people who are close to us. Sometimes it's a close family member. sometimes, and this is the hardest, it's a parent, it's a mother, it's a father. You know you've been wronged by that person, and sometimes this person has passed away. One of the best favors that you can do for yourself is forgive that person. If not for their sake, for your sake. Because sometimes a person, you might argue that they're not deserving of forgiveness. If you see it in that way, that they're not deserving of forgiveness, forgive them for your sake, not for their sake. So that you can be free. So that you don't have a burden on your shoulders. So number one is forgiving those who wrong you. Number two is keeping relations with those who terminate relations with you. Sometimes you have a dear friend or a family member that you've helped, that you've gone through a lot with, that you've been ups and downs with, and you've created a close bond or a close friendship with them, and all of a sudden they decide to terminate that relationship with you for whatever reason. You know, they found a spouse, or they found another friend, or they found another opportunity, and they forget about their friends. The Imam says that if they terminate relations with you, you continue relations with them. And number three, this goes back to the previous hadith, showing forbearance towards one who shows ignorance towards you. Because a lot of times when people hurt us, it's out of ignorance. It's out of stupidity. It's not out of knowledge. And you'll find that people who are known for constantly hurting others, they're not the brightest of people. Because if they were knowledgeable, if they were bright, if they were sharp, if they were knowledgeable, they would be mindful. They wouldn't be hurting people. So sometimes you have to have forbearance towards those who are ignorant towards you. And the Quran refers to the people, you know the word in Arabic, the word jahl. The word jahl refers to ignorance. But jahl also refers to, in its old meaning, it also refers to being rabid. When you're rabid, when you curse at someone, when you attack someone, when you're confrontational, that's also, because that comes from ignorance. Being rabid comes from, and being confrontational comes from being ignorant. If you've ever noticed some people, they're known for just being confrontational. They're not the smartest of people. So showing forbearance towards those who show ignorance towards you. And the third tradition, and I end with this. He says, a man will never be knowledgeable until two things. Until he has stopped envying those who are superior to him. Number one. Stop looking at people who are superior to you. If they have more than you, or if they're more influential, or if they're at a higher status than you. Stop envying that person. That's holding you back. Stop looking at those. Yeah, sometimes you can be ambitious, but being ambitious is different from envy. Clearly it's different from envy. Sometimes someone has something and they've set a high standard and you want the same for yourself. But sometimes you're jealous and you're envious of that person. Why does he have it? He doesn't deserve it. I deserve it. And there's a clear line between the two. So he says you will never attain knowledge until you stop being envious of those who you see as superior to you, number one, and scorning those who are inferior to you. Stop looking to the people that are beneath you. Stop using them as a standard. So these are three traditions from our fifth Imam, Al-Imam Muhammad Al-Baqir, alayhi salam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with their knowledge and their intercession. Again, I remind you just quickly that on Sunday is the day of Arafat. The woman will be holding a session here at the IECOC beginning at 12 o'clock. On Monday we have Salatul Eid. Doors open after 6:30. We will have Dua Nudbah and Takbirat beginning at 7:15. And at 8 o'clock sharp, we will have Salatul Eid. We hope to finish by before 9 o'clock. And one more announcement is that on Thursdays, our dear brother Waheed Haidari has volunteered from his time to provide Quran classes on Thursdays for all ages, from 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. And this is for all ages, beginner, intermediate, advanced, and it's completely free of charge. So we also... And Tuesday night, every night we have Dua Tawassul after Maghrib and Isha prayers. Immediately after Maghrib and Isha prayers. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allahumma ighfir lil mu'minina wal mu'minat wal muslimina wal muslimat al-ahya'i minhum wal amwat. تابع بيننا وبينهم بالخيرات، إنك مجيب الدعوات، إنك قاضي الحاجات، إنك على كل شيء قدير، برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين.